Welcome to the today's Hindu news analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. The display news articles for today's analysis along with their respective page numbers are displayed here for your reference. The PDF link of the handwritten notes along with the timestamping of the news articles is given in the description of the video as well as in the comment section for the benefit of the smart mobile users. Now let us begin with our first news article. This news article is about Ayodhya verdict. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article has been highlighted here for your reference. Know that this news article is with respect to the suit and the claims made by Nirmohi Akkara. And this Nirmohi Akkara claim, the Ram Janmabhoomi belongs to it. It also claims that it is Nirmohi Akkara that has managed the Ram Janmabhoomi and has received offerings from the people until 1949. The news article mentions that the Nirmohi Akkara claimed for shareholdership over the disputed property in Ayodhya. Note that the property here includes even the deities or idols in the Ram Janmabhoomi. In this context, we will see what is meant by shareholdership and the statement made by the Supreme Court in this regard. Know that a shareholder is a person or a group of persons who is vested with the authority to manage the properties of the deity. A shareholder will also ensure the purpose for which the property was dedicated. As a necessary additional role of this managerial role, a shareholder may hire pujaris for the performance of worship. In simple terms, shareholder means manager of the temple. This manager role was claimed by one of religious sects among the Hindus. And this religious sect which we are talking is about Nirmohi Akkara. To know the importance of this Nirmohi Akkara, you can refer the judgment of the Allahabad High Court. In its 2010 judgment, 1/3 of the disputed land was given to Nirmohi Akkara. But in the present and recent judgment of the Supreme Court has dismissed the suit filed by Nirmohi Akkara. But there is one relief for the Nirmohi Akkara sect, that is, the Nirmohi Akkara may be given an appropriate representation in the trust which is going to be formed by the central government. This trust is the trust which is mentioned under sections 6 and 7 of the Acquisition of Certain Area at Ayodhya Act of 1993. It is this trust that will be managing and handling three areas. One is the acquisition of rights under section 3 of this act of 1993. Then the possession of the inner and the outer courtyards in Ayodhya religious site. And finally the disputed property. So as per the Supreme Court, the Nirmohi Akkara sect has no role to play in the management of the properties involved in Ram Janmabhoomi verdict. However, they may be given a proper representation in the trust as the central government deems fit. So in this context, now let us see the statements made by the Supreme Court and why the statements made by the Supreme Court are important for us. This is because as per the Article 141 of the Indian Constitution, the law declared by the Supreme Court shall be binding on all courts within the territory of India. Here the law refers to the judgment of the Supreme Court in our case. Supreme Court said that one cannot be a sharebat just by the fact that he or she is offering worship in the temple. This means a pujari who just offers worship in the temple and receives offerings for the deity is not a manager of the temple or its premises. Now let us see who is a pujari. And you know that a pujari is a person who is a servant or appointee of the manager or sharebat. And a pujari will have no independent rights as a manager of a property even though he or she could have performed religious ceremonies for a long period of time. And one more thing is that the pujaris who are appointed by the sharebat, they are liable to be removed from office and they cannot claim a right to continue in the office of pujari. And these are the some of the statements made by the Supreme Court with respect to who is a pujari and a sharebat or a manager of a religious property. Now let us see that why the Nirmohi Akkara suit was rejected by the Supreme Court. This is mainly because of loss of limitation. That is, when a person claims a property, the claim has to be made within a particular time frame as governed under limitation laws. For example, an action takes place at your property, but if you don't claim your property and file a petition in the court, after a prescribed time, your claims could be rejected under the laws of limitation. Here, in the case of Nirmohi Agra also, it has delayed in filing their claims beyond 6 years. You know that in December 1949, the idols of Lord Rama were kept in the central dome of the Babri Masjid, and after this action and some other actions that happened in 1950, the Nirmohi Agra did not immediately claim their property in the court, and it has filed a petition only in 1959. Therefore, the Supreme Court, under the laws of limitation, has dismissed the suits and claims of Nirmohi Agra sect. The limitation law that applied for the limitation for 1950s was the Limitation Act of 1908. And this law, that is the Limitation Act of 1908, was in force when Nirmohi Agra filed their petition in court of law in 1959. So you can say that the suits and claims filed by Nirmohi Agra and the rejection of their claims by Supreme Court is based on laws of limitation. Therefore, with respect to this news article, we saw about Sherbait, meaning the manager of the temple, and the one of the religious sect called Nirmohi Agra, and the meaning of pujari, and whether the pujaris are having the rights or to manage the property of the temple. And also we have discussed briefly about the Supreme Court judgment and why the Supreme Court has rejected the claims and suits by the Nirmohi Agra sect. So with this, we have come to the end of the analysis of this news article. The displayed practice question will be discussed at the end of the session. Now let us move on to the analysis of next news article. Now look at this news article. It says that India's plastic exports for the month of September 2019 declined by 16.8% as compared to September 2018. The syllabus relevance of this news article is given here for your reference. You may think that this news article is full of facts and how these facts are relevant for your exam. Know that these facts may be not relevant for us, but the key takeaways from this article is that what are these exporting items mentioned in this news article, and who are importing these items, and what could be the reasons for low exports of these materials. And we'll also see briefly about Plastics Export Promotion Council, which is also mentioned in this news article. Now let us see that the important plastic export items from India are plastic raw materials, optical items, molded goods, human hair products, packaging materials, etc. This article mentions that the reasons for the low export is low sales in major importing countries such as China, Indonesia, Vietnam, and some other European countries. As per the article, the immediate reasons for this sudden drop in sales are unclear, but one can say that the reason might be the global slowdown in economic activities. Now let us see that who are importing these products from India. The products from Indian plastic industry are exported to over 200 countries across the globe. The top destinations are Italy, Germany, and UK in Europe, Nigeria, South Africa, and Kenya in Africa, Bangladesh, Nepal, and Sri Lanka in South Asia, and Vietnam and Indonesia in Asian, and also US and China. Now we'll see briefly about the important Export Promotion Council, which was mentioned in this article. That is Plastics Export Promotion Council, in short PLEX Council. Know that it was established as a non-profit organization under the Companies Act of 1956, and now it functions under the Ministry of Commerce and Industry, and it was one of several export promotion councils launched by the government of India to project India's image as a reliable supplier of high quality products in order to give a boost to the country's exports. Know that PLEX Council is the apex body of the plastics industry in India and represents over 2,500 exporters who manufactures or trades in plastics products ranging from plastic raw materials to semi-finished and finished products. And thus, with reference to this news article, we have seen that what are the products that are exported and who are the countries importing these items and the reasons for low exports of these materials. And also we discussed about Plastics Export Promotion Council. With this, we have come to the end of this news article. Now let us move on to the next news article analysis. This news article is about the Index of Industrial Production for the month of September 2019. It says that IIP contracted sharply by 4.3%, but in contrast, IIP has witnessed a growth of about 4.3% in the month of September of 2018. For your reference, the syllabus relevance of this news article is highlighted here. Now, with respect to this news article, we'll be discussing about IIP, on what parameters IIP is estimated and who releases it, and why industrial activity now witnessing declining trends. And these are the some of the important aspects in terms of your exam point of view. Now look at the news article. It says that the decline of about 4.3% is the highest decline. That is, it has reached the lowest IIP ever since October 2011. For your reference, in the month of October 2011, it has shrunk by 5%. The worrying factor is that all three major sectors under IIP, such as mining, manufacturing and electricity sectors, witnessed economic slowdown. Now, in this context, let us discuss in brief about the Index of Industrial Production. Note that IIP is an index that shows the performance of different industrial sectors of the Indian economy. IIP is estimated and published on a monthly basis by the Central Statistical Organization under the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. It measures the short-term changes in the volume of production of a basket of industrial products during a given period with respect to that a chosen base period, which is now 2011 to 2012. And the present basket now has about 407 items under the three broad categories of mining, manufacturing and electricity. Now you look at the table, the weightage of these sectors are mentioned. For example, mining is having the weightage of about 14%. The manufacturing is having the weightage of about 77.63%. And then electricity is having the weightage of 7.99%. Note that this tabular column is very important for your exam point of view. You can expect the questions mostly based on the weightage given to these sectors. Further, it is to be noted that there are 8 core industries within IIP. They comprise about 40.27% of the total weight of the items that are included in the IIP. And these core industries are like coal, crude oil, natural gas, refinery products, fertilizers, steel, cement and electricity. Now you see the tabular column. You can see the weightage of this 8 core industries within IIP. And this table is also very important for your prelims exam point of view. Now let us look at the news article. Here, whatever the data that are mentioned in the news article may not be important for us, but the important facts are like the manufacturing sector was contracted by about 8.5%. The manufacturing sector is also contracted by 3.9%. Even the electricity sector also contracted by 2.6%. It means that all the three subsectors of Index of Industrial Production like mining, manufacturing and electricity are witnessing decreasing trends. Now look at this graph, which is indicating the IIP activity over the last few years. From the graph you can say that, and it is also very clear that the IIP is witnessing a steep decline in the recent times, and now it has reached the lowest value. This indicates that the Indian economy is facing a structural slowdown. As per the news article, they are mentioning that the origin of the slowdown is in rural areas. Now you might be thinking that how the slowdown in rural areas is impacting the lower industrial activity. For example, a stagnated growth of around 1% in the agriculture sector and the rising rural employment has resulted in very low income for the rural households. This in turn would affect their savings. When the savings is less, the demand will also be less. And you know that about 2/3 of Indian population lives in rural areas, Therefore, whenever there is a slowdown in rural areas, it would be having multiplier effect on other sectors, including industrial activity. With this information, we have come to the end of discussion of this news article. And with respect to this news article, we have discussed the definition of index of industrial production and who releases IIP and what basis are the parameters in which the measurement or estimation of IIP is done and why the present industrial activity is declining. Have a look at the practice question, which will be discussed at the end of the session. Now let us move on to the next news article analysis. This news article is about the selection of Suranga Bavadi, which is located in Vijayapura of Karnataka and is selected for the World Monument Watch List for 2020. The syllabus linking of this news article is given here for your reference. In this context, we will be discussing what is meant by Suranga Bavadi and also ancient system of Karesh. So that is the underground supply of water system and the historical perspective of Karesh system of supplying water. Then World Monument Watch List will be discussed. Now let us start our analysis for this article. Note that Suranga Bavadi is a part of ancient Karesh system of supplying water through subterranean tunnels, that is underground tunnels. Know that this Karesh system is selected under the category of historic water systems of the Deccan Plateau for World Monument Watch List. To understand better about Karesh system, in simple terms, it is an underground water supply system. Here the source of water can be surface water, and even in some cases the groundwater also provides as an alternative source. Know that in much of Asia and North Africa, underground tunnels were developed to harness groundwater, and these tunnels are called as Karesh or Kananth or Fallas system. You see the diagram. The diagram is with respect to Karesh system. You can notice that a gently sloping underground tunnels allows groundwater from a large area to flow into a single outlet where it can be collected. And also you can see that a large well is placed at the source of the tunnel, and the narrow vertical shafts which are dug up for ventilation and maintenance. And also you can notice that underground tunnels, and these tunnels enable collected water to be used for irrigation or other purposes. Now let us discuss Karesh from the historical perspective. This article has mentioned that this Karesh system of underground tunnel system was built in the 16th century by Ali Adil Shah I. In this context, we'll see that the Deccan region in India, which was ruled by the Bahmani Sultanate, and they ruled majority of the present day Karnataka, parts of Maharashtra and Telangana during 14th century to 16th century. And the later the kingdom split into five groups that were collectively known as the Deccan Sultanate. And they are Ahmednagar, the present Berar, Bidar, Bijapur and Golconda Sultanates. Note that one of the five Deccan Sultanate was the Sultanate of Bijapur, and Yusuf Adil Shah was the founder of this Sultanate. Hence it is also called as the Adil Shahi dynasty, and they ruled the Deccan for almost till the end of 17th century. And it is believed that the Karesh of Bijapur was created by the Adil Shahi rulers in the 16th century. As per this news article, you can see that the Karesh underground system, which was built in the 16th century by Ali Adil Shah I and later his successor Ibrahim Adil Shah II, added more structure to strengthen it. And this is about historical perspective of Karesh underground system. And now we'll focus in brief about the old monument watch list. Know that monuments under this list is selected by Old Monuments Fund, and it is a New York based NGO which was founded in 1965 with an objective of saving and restoring the ancient monuments across the globe. And this monument watch list is a global program which was launched in 1995 and with an aim to identify the cultural heritage sites and to provide financial and technical support for their restoration. And this Karesh system which we are discussing is also selected for this prestigious World Monument Watch List for 2020 along with 24 other monuments from across the world. Know that another monument from India which is selected for 2020 World Monument Watch List is the Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel Stadium, which is located in Ahmedabad of Gujarat. As we have mentioned earlier, an inclusion in the list will get these sites financial and technical assistance for their maintenance as well as restoration. Therefore, with respect to this news article, we have discussed what is meant by the CARES system. So that is a underground water supply system, and when it was developed, and also the importance of selection of this CARES system for the World Monument Watch List for 2020. Have a look at this practice question. We'll be discussing this question at the end of the session. Now let us move on to the next news article. This news article is based on a research study on anemia. For your reference, the syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article has been highlighted here. This news article presents the findings of a research study on anemia on men. The article on this research study was published recently on the Lancet Global Health Journal. This research study is special because it gave attention for anemia among men. You know that usually research studies will pay attention for mostly women and children whenever it is about anemia, because the prevalence of anemia is much higher in women than in men. This research study on anemia on men has found out results that many people in society may not believe it. As per the research study, higher prevalence of anemia in states can be seen to the tune of around 32.9% in Bihar. In case of Manipur, there is lowest prevalence to the tune of just 9.2% according to this study. Among the participants of this study, the national prevalence of anemia among the men of the age group of 15 to 54 years is about 22.5%, whereas the prevalence of anemia among women is around 50.3%, and these numbers are based on the results of this study. Now look at the table, and this table gives the details of demographic characteristics of analyzable survey participants. It says that the severe anemia in case of total participants is about 1.9%, and in case of men it is about 0.5%, and in case of women it is about 2.2%. In addition, we can say that in India, 1 in 2 women are anemic and 1 in 5 men are anemic. Among those who are anemic in women, around 26.7% have moderate or severe anemia. The same situation for men is just 4.8%. That is, only about 4.8% of men who are anemic are having severe or moderate anemia. See, around 45% of anemic men are in the age group of 15 to 29 years, and in the same age group about 49% of women are anemic. So in this context, let us see what is anemia and what are severe and moderate anemia among men and women based on WHO recommendations. For men, if their hemoglobin concentration was lower than 13 grams per deciliter, then it is called as a simply anemic. It is called as moderate anemia if the hemoglobin concentration was lower than 11 grams per deciliter but not lower than 8 grams per deciliter. In case of severe anemia, it is defined by having hemoglobin concentration lower than 8 grams per deciliter. For non-pregnant women, if their hemoglobin concentration was lower than 12 grams per deciliter, then it is called as simply anemic. It is called as moderate anemia if the hemoglobin concentration was lower than 11 grams per deciliter but not lower than 8 grams per deciliter. In case of severe anemia, it is defined by having hemoglobin concentration lower than 8 grams per deciliter. Know that anemia is a condition where there is an insufficient number of red blood cells. It also means that the oxygen carrying capacity of red blood cells is insufficient to meet physiologic needs of the human body. If this is the case, where from hemoglobin comes into the picture? Who is playing a major role in taking oxygen from the lungs to the tissues in human body? It is a protein in the red blood cells, and the name of this protein is hemoglobin. So the level of oxygen carrying capacity is measured based on the level of presence of hemoglobin in blood. This is how hemoglobin comes into the picture of measurement of anemia, moderate anemia and severe anemia. Therefore, with reference to this news article, we have discussed what is meant by anemia and its different types like moderate, severe forms, and also the percentages of anemic in case of men and women, and which state is having highest percentage of men with anemia, and also the research study which was published recently on the Lancet Global Health Journal. So with this, we have come to the end of analysis of this news article. Have a look at the practice question. We'll discuss at the end of the session. Now let us move on to the next news article. This discussion is based on the editorial about the OOC Citizen of India. The discussion can be linked to the syllabus that is given here for your reference. This editorial is based on the recent controversy about the cancellation of OOC Citizen of India card, that is OCI card, of a writer named Atish Tasir by the Indian government. The controversy is that the writer is accusing the government that the government only sent him the notice of revocation of OCI card after he had written an article criticizing our Prime Minister. But this accusation has been denied by the government, and the government has given a different reason for revocation of his OCI card. You know that the Ministry of Home Affairs is the central ministry in dealing with all aspects of OCI card. And the Ministry of Home Affairs accused the writer of concealment of material facts and false representation when he applied for his original person of Indian origin status in 2000. The ministry has stated that he did this by not revealing some facts about his biological father. As per the reports, his biological father is a former governor of Punjab province of Pakistan, and his father had both British citizenship as well as Pakistani citizenship. Therefore, in this context, we'll be discussing about what are the conditions to obtain an OCI card and what kind of benefits one can get by holding this OCI card. Can government cancel or revoke this card? These are the aspects that we are going to discuss with respect to this editorial. See, we know that the Constitution of India does not allow holding Indian citizenship and the citizenship of a foreign country simultaneously, but there were persistent demands for dual citizenship, particularly from the diaspora in North America and other developed countries. So based on the recommendation of the High-Level Committee on Indian Diaspora, the Government of India decided to register persons of Indian origin, that is PIOs of certain category, as Overseas Citizenship of India card holder, or in short OCI card holder. For this purpose, the Overseas Citizenship of India scheme was introduced by the government by amending the Citizenship Act of 1955 through the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2005. The scheme provides for registration of all persons of Indian origin, that is PIOs, as Overseas Citizen of India. Know that a PIO is a person who was an Indian national or whose any of ancestors was an Indian national and who is presently holding another country's citizenship or nationality. That is, he or she is holding foreign passport. So, now according to Section 7A of the Citizenship Act of 1955, a person can be registered as OCI card holder. Remember that OCI should not be misunderstood as dual citizenship. It is not a dual citizenship as OCI does not confer political rights. The registered OCI citizen of India shall not be entitled to the rights conferred on a citizen of India under Article 16 of the Constitution, which says that equality of opportunity in matters of public employment. Then the persons registered as OCI card holder have not been given any voting rights, election to Lok Sabha or Rajya Sabha or Legislative Assembly or Legislative Council. Even OCI card holder cannot hold constitutional posts such as President, Office of Vice President, Office of Judges of Supreme Court or Judge of High Court. Now, we'll see who are eligible to register as OCI card holder and what kind of benefits they will get. The foreign nationals of the following category are eligible to register as OCI card holder. Firstly, the person who was a citizen of India or who was eligible to become a citizen of India or at any time after the commencement of the constitution, that is after 26th January 1950, which was the date of commencement of the constitution of India. Then, a person who belonged to a territory that became part of India after 15th August 1947, that is, after India's independence, is also eligible. You know that the territories that became part of India after India's independence are Sikkim, Puducherry, Dadra and Nagar Haveli, Goa and Daman and Diu. Then, a person who is a minor child or a grandchild or a great-grandchild of such a citizen mentioned above are also eligible to get OCI card. Then also the spouse of a citizen of India who is of foreign origin or the spouse of an overseas citizen of India card holder who is of foreign origin is also eligible to register as OCI card holder. Now in this we saw that a foreign national of this category are eligible. But here you have to keep one point in mind. A person who is or had been a citizen of Pakistan or Bangladesh or a person whose either of parents or grandparents or great grandparents is having or had been a citizen of Pakistan or Bangladesh is not eligible to register as OCI card holder. Then if the OCI card holder acquires nationality of a different country after obtaining the OCI card except the citizenship of Pakistan and Bangladesh, then he or she shall also be allowed to enter India, exit India based on their new passport of the recently acquired nationality and OCI registration certificate. So, we can say that the rules prohibit any person with Pakistani lineage or Bangladesh lineage from obtaining this OCI status. Now, keep these points in mind with respect to the controversy because the government has stated that the biological father of the writer Atish Tasir is a former governor of Punjab province of Pakistan and his father also had British citizenship as well as Pakistani citizenship. So, by this we can say that he was not eligible to obtain citizenship based on these reasons. But the writer reply to this accusation is that his parents were not legally married. Now, we'll see whether the government can cancel the registration of a person as OCI card holder. Note that the central government can cancel the registration of OCI of any person based on Section 7D of Citizenship Act of 1955. Under Section 7D Clause A, the central government can cancel if it is satisfied that the registration as an overseas citizen of India was obtained or by means of false representation or the concealment of any material fact. And these reasons can be the valid reasons for the central government to cancel or the revocation of the OCI card. So, based on this provision only, the writer's OCI card holder registration is being cancelled by the central government. Now, with all this background in your mind, let us discuss the editorial. The author criticizes the government for cancellation of the registration of the writer as OCI card holder. For this, author mentions that in the manifesto of the present government in 2014, they stated that NRIs, PIOs, that is persons of Indian origins and professionals settled abroad need to be harnessed or used for strengthening brand India. So, author is noting that by cancelling the overseas citizen of India card of the writer, the government has shown that this promise was not so serious. The author is also criticizing the government that the government did not choose to examine the writer's maternal links. He is stating this because our former External Affairs Minister, Srimati Sushma Swaraj, has mentioned in 2018 that there were some changes made to ease the process of issue of passport. One of the changes was that the online passport application form would now require the applicant to provide either the name of father or mother or legal guardian, that is, name of only one parent and not both of the parents is now required. So this enabled single parents to apply for passports for their children. Now, based on this, the author is questioning that if the state can grant a passport to a child based on a single mother's application, then why the writer's maternal links with India were not taken into consideration. As per the author, the OCI card strengthens the bond with India because of benefits available to the OCI card holders. As a registered citizen of India, of overseas, is granted multiple entries to India, multi-purpose visa, lifelong visa for visiting India, and these are the benefits available for OCI card holders. The OCI card holder is also exempted from registration with Foreigners Regional Registration Officer or Foreigners Registration Officer for any length of stay in India. Even they are treated on par with the non-resident Indians or NRIs in respect of all facilities available to them in matters of economic, financial matters and educational fields. As per the author, the card is particularly useful for professionals, business persons and even politicians of Indian origin who live abroad, such as who lives in the United States, the Caribbeans, Europe, Southeast Asia, Africa, Canada, Latin America and the Pacific Islands. So, from these benefits, author infers that the OCI card helps the owner in most day-to-day economic and social activities while they are in India. Hence, the card strengthens the bond that the card holder feels for India. Next, the author notes that denying the OCI card using Section 7D of the Citizenship Act is problematic. The author mentions some of the consequences of this denial. Firstly, this move of government will lead to the possibility of similar treatment to orphan children, adopted children and the children born to single mothers. In future also, these children may not be able to obtain OCI status, or those who have got the status already, the status could be revoked. In future, these children may not be able to obtain OCI status, or those who have got the status already, the status could also be revoked in future. It is because we can clearly see that the biological parents and their origin of these children might be known, so they might be treated in the same manner. Secondly, the same clause of the Act can also be used against any OCI card holder who might have a child out of wedlock. The card holder's partner could be from a country that the Indian state does not have good relations with. Like in case of this writer, as he claims that his parents were never legally married. Thirdly, the author also worries that some other country could also be added to the list with Pakistan and Bangladesh. This is because, as we saw already, according to the Section 7A of Citizenship Act of 1955, a person who is or had been a citizen of Pakistan or Bangladesh, or a person whose either parents or grandparents or great-grandparents is having or had been a citizen of Pakistan or Bangladesh is not eligible to register as OCI card holder. In addition to this, if the person belongs to any other country which the central government by notification in the official gazette has specified, then that person is also not eligible to get to register as OCI card holder. So, if any such thing is done, then person belong to such country will also be in trouble. So, these are the some of the consequences that are mentioned by author in this editorial. So, with respect to this editorial, we have discussed the eligibility criteria for getting OCI card and benefits of OCI card holder, and we have also discussed the recent cancellation of Writers OCA Accord and also the possible consequences of the recent action by the Government of India. And these are the some of the aspects that we have discussed with respect to this news article. And the displayed practice question will be discussed at the end of the session. Now let us move on to the next session. Let us start our practice prelims question session. Now look at this question. They have given three statements with respect to Sarbhai Pujari, and the law declared by the Supreme Court is binding only on the high courts under Article 141 of the Indian Constitution. And for this question, you have to choose the correct option. Statement 1 says that a Sarbhai is vested with authority to manage the properties of the deity. In this context, you should know that what is the meaning of Sarbhai. And in simple terms, you can say that Sarbhai is a person or a group of persons who is vested with the authority to manage the properties of the deity. I can say that Sarbhai means manager of the temple, and the Sarbhai will also ensure the fulfillment of the purpose for which the property was dedicated, and even they can take additional role of hiring pujaris for the performing of worship. Therefore, statement 1 is correct. Then the second statement reads like this: a pujari can attain the status of Sarbhai by performing religious worship ceremonies and receiving offerings for the deity for a long period of time. Note that as per the recent Supreme Court verdict, a pujari means he is a servant or an appointee of the Sarbhai. Note that a pujari will have no independent right as a manager of a property, though the pujari could have performed worshipping or religious ceremonies for a long period of time. Even these pujaris who are appointed by Sarbhai are liable to be removed from office, and once removed, they cannot claim a right to continue in the office of pujari. Thus, second statement is incorrect. Now consider the third statement. It says that the law declared by the Supreme Court is binding only on high courts under the Article 141 of the Indian Constitution. Know that as per the Article 141, the law declared by the Supreme Court shall be binding on all courts within the territory of India. Therefore, the third statement is also incorrect. So, for this question, second and third statements are incorrect, but first statement is correct. Thus, option D, 1 only, is the correct option for this question. Now, look at this question. This question is about anemia. They have given two statements and you have to choose the correct option for this question. Here the first statement says that anemia is a condition where the red blood cells have insufficient oxygen carrying capacity to meet the physiological needs. And the second statement is that in India, the prevalence of anemia is more among women than among men. You know that anemia is a condition where the red blood cells have insufficient oxygen carrying capacity to meet our day-to-day physiologic needs, and anemia also refers to having insufficient RBO count in the body, and it is measured using the hemoglobin levels in terms of grams per deciliter. Thus, first statement is correct. As per the research study, in India, more than 50% of women are anemic, and in case of men, the prevalence is to the tune of around 20 to 25% only. So second statement is also correct. So for this question, option C, both 1 and 2 are correct. Now look at this question. This question is about Kare system. Here two statements are given and you have to choose the correct option. The statement 1 says that the Kare system or the subterranean tunnels used to harness groundwater, and second statement says that the Kare of Bijapur was promoted by the Adil Shahi dynasty during the 16th century. You know that in Asia and North Africa, underground tunnels were developed to harness the surface water as well as groundwater. And these tunnels are called as Karej or Kananth or Fallas systems. In case of Karej system, a gently sloping underground tunnels allows groundwater or surface water from a larger area to flow into a single outlet where it can be collected and can be used for irrigation or such other purposes. Thus, given statement 1 is correct. Also know that the Sultanate of Bijapur, that is Adil Shahi rulers in the 16th century, promoted this Karej system of underground water harnessing practices. Note that the Karej underground system was built in the 16th century by Ali Adil Shahi I, and later his successor Ibrahim Adil Shah II added more structure to strengthen this system. Therefore, second statement is correct. Thus, for this question, option C, both 1 and 2 are correct. Now, look at this question. This question is based on index of industrial production. They have given 3 statements and you have to choose the correct option for this question. And statement 1 says that IIP measures the short term changes in the prices of a basket of industrial products during a given period with respect to that a chosen base period. So here the statement 1 says that the short term changes in the prices of a basket of industrial products. You know that IIP measures the short term changes in the volume of production of a basket of industrial products, but not the price changes. Thus, given statement 1 is incorrect. Now, look at the second statement. Within the IIP, the manufacturing sector has the maximum weightage. You know that IIP was estimated based on the 3 broad categories like mining, manufacturing, and electricity. Altogether, it constitutes about 407 items. The weightage for mining subsector is having about 14.37%, and for manufacturing the weightage is about 77.63%, and in case of electricity the weightage is about 7.99%. So if you look at the weightage for the mining, manufacturing and electricity, manufacturing is having the highest weightage in the estimation of IIP. Therefore, second statement is correct. And also note that IIP is released on a monthly basis by the Central Statistical Organization under the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. Thus, third statement is also correct. So, for this question, option B, all statements except one is correct answer. Now, look at this practice mains question. The question says, the overseas citizenship of India strengthens the bond that the holder feels for India. What are the benefits the overseas citizenship of India card holders entitled to? And also discuss the recent developments with respect to OCI card holders and its consequences. For this question, we request to post your answers in the comment section, and your answer would be evaluated based on the requirement of the question given. And also suitable guidance will be given within a reasonable time period. And we have noticed that some of the aspirants are writing very good answers and other aspirants' answers also improving. Kindly note that, dear aspirants, mains is about writing practice. Write whatever you feel relevant for the question and try to know your strengths and weaknesses. But step by step, you will gain the confidence in writing the mains examination. So with this, we have come to the end of the today's analysis. Please do like, comment, share and subscribe Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel. Thank you.